I'm sorry. Hello, angels. As many of you are very well aware of, the people in positions of power in Philadelphia's queer nightlife have had so many opportunities to learn how to apologize, and yet they fail over and over and over. I'm sorry. In this video, I'm going to be using the apologies found in the Philly Black Queer and Burlesque Townhall as artifacts to reflect on. I'm going to try to make this a teachable account of how to make an apology and what to avoid when you're composing your apologies. Let's start with some context. For those unaware of the egregious acts of inequity in Philadelphia nightlife, here are some accounts of what folks have been dealing with. Lack of representation. In a city where there are more people of color than white folks, nearly every white-produced show consists of more white artists on stage than there are black and brown folks. In my own experience, I have been a part of shows where I'm the only person of color on stage, or I'm one of two out of the entire cast. I also recognize that people of color with lighter skin, like myself, get more opportunity to be on stage and see greater representation than folks with darker skin. I acknowledge that Latinx folks are given more recognition in comparison to black folks. White producers are called out often for their lack of representation in small-scale ways. Their response is to glorify one, two, or a small handful of people of color to showcase that they are not racist. The goal shouldn't be an attempt at not being racist. It should be to act with anti-racism at the forefront, providing only a few black folks with opportunity in order to meet a quota like some backwards college admission golden ticket is only hiding your racism, disguising it as representation when all it is tokenism. And for those who are still not clear about what tokenism is, it is when we make a decision or take an action that would symbolize that you've done a good thing without actually doing the good thing. It's giving one or two black folks opportunity while continuing to disproportionately provide more opportunity to white folks while you call yourself an ally. You're not an ally, Brenda. Mistreatment of people of color. There are a multitude of accounts when people in positions of power have responded to the needs of white artists significantly differently to the needs of black artists. When white artists seek critique or guidance regarding their art, they are often met with opportunity and a helping hand. However, when black artists ask for the same treatment, white artists are more distant, they are more likely to ignore the call for support, and way too often, criticize black artists publicly as a response. It can sometimes be as egregious as a white judge making racist remarks on the microphone to a black artist seeking critique in a room full of people. The double standard. People in power in the context of nightlife have the power to provide work to the artists of Philadelphia and beyond. You may wonder, how do these people choose which artists get the job? Well, I can certainly tell you that who gets the job most often physically looks like the person providing the job. Folks who do not resemble the person in power have a harder time being booked. Why? Because there are two separate standards for those who are white and those who are black. Not only do white artists have more access to mentorship, but they also have access to a set of standards less rigorous to the standards of people of color. A white artist who may need some work has a higher chance at gaining opportunity than black artists who may need the same amount of work. In many cases, white artists who are significantly less polished, less funny, less talented, who are less friendly, will still have a greater chance at opportunity than black artists who are, quite frankly, stronger artists and better people. For added nuance, it is very apparent that white folks will get praise for behaving in an anti-racist manner, even if it took them quite a long time to reject that way of behaving, you know, in a racist manner. However, when people of color outwardly behave in anti-racist ways, perhaps they provide a performance regarding social justice or social advocacy, or perhaps they create a whole show specifically to raise money. Whatever the case, they will receive significantly less recognition than the white person who put in minimal effort. It is a double standard that glorifies whiteness and ignores blackness. Lack of accountability. Now that we've laid out some and just some of the issues in Philly nightlife, it is important to consider how those people in power have responded. Here are some ways we've seen them behave. After being called out, it is not uncommon that the people block advocates on social media. They blacklist performers from their shows and other shows in the city. They speak ill of them to other producers, audience members, and staff at their venues. They engage in politicized name-calling. Many of us have been called social justice warriors, are told we should get a job or a hobby, should get the hell off of Facebook, amongst other things. And in the most egregious cases, people in power have been called out for pushing folks, screaming in their faces, and laughing at them from across the room. Very seldom is the response an apology. And when there is an apology heard because their dirty laundry is aired out for the world to see, it is often a piss-poor apology. And this is where the teaching happens. It is in my hope that folks will learn how to apologize to make amends with those they've hurt. Now, I'm not saying making an apology nullifies any behavior. I'm not even saying that person should even keep their job or ever work in the city again. What I'm saying is that acknowledging the pain of Black folks in the city through a well-constructed apology is the absolute least someone can do. Here's some tips on how to apologize. Acknowledgement. One of the most impactful things you can do when apologizing is to directly, concisely, and accurately describe what you did wrong or how you hurt someone. What this does is tell the victim that you have full awareness of the issue. If you apologize without articulating exactly what you're apologizing for, then it's virtually useless. It's like apologizing to the wind instead of the person you targeted. Here's a tip to avoid empty apologies. Take out a piece of paper and pen. No matter how long it takes, write out every single detail of what you have done wrong. Feel free to write out every nuance. Do you feel you really did anything wrong? Do you feel a sense of regret? What happened first, second, last? What excuses do you have? Write everything out so that when you do actually apologize, you aren't fumbling around trying to figure out what to say. This way, you're less likely to say things you don't actually mean and leave out the stuff that is not going to support your apology and, more importantly, support the person you are apologizing to. Verbal and/or written accountability. This step is often where an apology starts and ends. Taking accountability can sound an awful lot like the words, "I'm sorry," or "I apologize." For me personally, these words and phrases are pretty empty, but they are appreciated. When you say, "I did this specific thing and it hurt you in this specific way, and I apologize for that. I'm sorry I behaved that way." What this does is say in words that you recognize your wrongdoing and feel remorse for that wrongdoing affecting someone else. You are showing that you have some sympathy for the victim. And for some, this is very necessary. For others, like myself, it doesn't do much for us after we've been slighted. What I am looking for instead is accountability in the form of an actionable promise. Actionable accountability. A promise is something that is very unique. When we say the words, "I promise," we are actually putting that promise into reality. When we say other words like "chair," it doesn't mean a chair is there. When we say "jump," it doesn't mean we've actually jumped. But when we say, "I promise," we are actually doing something. We are making that promise. And this is very meaningful to me, and I'm sure for many others as well. Promising actionable accountability means you will actively engage in atonement. This can look like promising to never behave in the same ways and actually refraining from doing so. And perhaps promising that you will take a specific action if you fail at that promise. Something like, "If I behave poorly in the future, I promise to relinquish my position as a person with power." You could also provide reparations in the form of service or money or opportunity. So let's quickly recap. To make an apology, you must acknowledge your wrongdoing, outwardly provide an apology, and atone for your wrongdoings by taking an appropriate action or making a promise. You may think this is pretty simple stuff, but there have been many, many people who have gotten it wrong. So in this last segment, I would like to share some piss poor apologies with you so you will learn what not to do when apologizing. Let's take a look at our first apology. "I've done my best. I'm sorry you haven't seen that." This is quite frankly not an apology. It reads as though the apologizer is saying, you should apologize for not seeing all the hard work I've done. It does not acknowledge the faulty action and puts blame on the victim for not being observant enough to avoid victimization on their own. Here's another apology. I try to be a good person. It is not my intention to hurt others. I'm sorry. In comparison, this looks like a much better apology than the last, but it's just as disingenuous. If you have to put your ego on your sleeve and beg for everyone to see you as a good person before you apologize, you don't really mean it. All you want is to not be seen as a bad person, and you'll apologize only because there's a chance at redemption for your brand or the way people perceive you. Here's a similar apology. My casting is diverse in every other city, but I missed the mark in this city. I'm sorry. Similarly to the previous, the apologizer is building the ethos or their credibility before apologizing in hopes that their established credibility will lessen the blow of their actions. Consider how different the apology would have turned out if they said, I missed the mark, and for that, I apologize. This is a little bit more genuine, but instead they're basically saying, every other time I was tasked to meet the mark, I was successful, but it is only in this one teeny tiny instance that I missed it, so I'm sorry. You should own up to your failures, not praise your successes, then pretend like your one failure isn't as impactful as it is because you've had other successes. Let's look at this next round of apologies, and fair warning, they're doozies. I'm sorry, I'm a different person than who I was back then. I'm sober now. I'm shy in public, so I come across as standoffish, so I apologize. Listen, I've experienced mental health issues. In fact, I recognize that I hate myself so much that it made me act out and project that hatred. I'm sorry. I'm dealing with my own gender identity, so I apologize that I hurt others dealing with theirs. I'm in therapy now. I'm doing much better. I apologize for what I did in my past. All of these apologies are akin to the previous, insofar that they all try to deflect the impact by adding more words than necessary. Notice how each one centers the apology on themselves? What does apologizing to someone you hurt have to do with your therapy, or your identities, or your struggle, or your sobriety? You hurt someone. Regardless of your life story, you did something that negatively impacted other people. So please, avoid centering yourself and perhaps give a little more attention to the people around you. This next apology is very common and always gets under my skin. You know when people say, I'm sorry if. Saying, I'm sorry if I hurt you is the same as saying, I don't think I actually hurt you. But if in some kind of alternate universe my doppelganger did something to you, if and only if that happened, then I'm sorry. But I'm not sorry right now because there's no proof. This is literally not an apology at all because it doesn't recognize that they've done anything wrong. This next apology is basically a backhanded compliment. I thought we were close. I thought we were friends. I thought we were all joking around. Sorry, that was my misstep. This apology is directly designed to schmooze up the victim, call them a friend so they take the apology more willingly. It's very manipulative. But here's another thing. You're also saying, I thought we were friends, meaning now that you've called me out, we aren't friends. And guess what? It's your fault we aren't friends. Clearly, you can see how this also blames the victim. Let's hear some more apologies. I'm sorry, and I'm happy to sit down with anyone who has had an issue with me. This apology puts onus on the victims to have a conversation to work things out. So not only do they get victimized, but then they have to talk it out, and with the person who victimized them? Why add this additional labor to someone who's been already hurt? This non-apology is very similar. I'm sorry, and I'm here to learn. So if you could explain this issue to me so I don't do it again, that'd be great. In saying this, you are, for one, expecting others to provide labor that is your responsibility. And furthermore, the apologizer is feigning ignorance as an excuse. Oh, if only I had known that this action I took hurt others, I wouldn't have done it. Please teach me how to not hurt others anymore. And until then, I'm not guilty. Listen, I recognize that this segment was a lot to take in. There were lots of words coming at you very fast, and I recognized that it could be a lot to digest, making it a bit exhausting for the viewer. I'm sorry about that. But here's what I can promise. I made this a video so you can watch over and over as many times as you need to digest the information. I hope you can forgive me. And in the meantime, here's a little recap to help make things a little bit more digestible. Do not center yourself in the apology. The people who were hurt should be the focus instead. Avoid using rhetorical devices such as building your ethos to lessen the blow of the apology or distract folks from the impact of the harm. Don't apologize if you committed an atrocity. Apologize because you undeniably have. Don't throw people under the bus or slip in any slide remarks during the apology. Don't ask others to do the legwork of learning or working on the issue when it's your responsibility to do so. Don't pretend like you were ignorant and innocent because of that ignorance. You know that you did something wrong, own up to it, and commit to being better. And provide some reparations. Thank you so much for listening in. I hope this little lesson will follow you the next time you make a boo-boo and need to apologize for it. Until then, see you next time, angels. Bye-bye.